Hello, everyone. Welcome to our Faith Gateway Author Chats. I'm Sammy Cohn, your host. I'm the Chief Curator of the Family section at faithgateway.com, and I am so excited to be joined today by two very special ladies. You may know them, Chris Howard and Corey Robertson. How are you doing today, ladies?
Hey, we're doing great. We're so happy to be here. This is our first time to ever do this.
I'm your first.
Yes. We've done all kinds of things in the last couple of years with Duck Dynasty, but this is our first live chat, so we're excited about it. And I guess should I just introduce my mom?
Well, let me let everyone know how they can join in really quick before you do that. I want to make sure that people know that, like you said, Corey, this is live. We want you all to participate with us. So if you have questions for Corey or Chris or them both, make sure you tweet to us live using the hashtag FaithCommander, and you can use @FaithGateway as well. We are going to be talking about their new book, obviously, Faith Commander, and the resources that go along with it. We've got some great deals that you can check out right below where you're watching this. There's a link to the Faith Gateway store. We're offering a special code, Commander. When you enter Commander, you're actually going to be able to save 40% off retail on any of the Faith Commander products. So you can do that. But yeah, Corey, why don't you go ahead and introduce you and your mom for us, please?
Okay. I thought I should introduce my mom because you don't see her on Duck Dynasty. It's a shame.
Every now and then.
Let's work on fixing that.
I've been working on that a little bit.
Sammy, I'm up to 15 seconds.
Hey, that's all we can ask for, Chris.
That's right. Yeah.
Well, I don't know if I can handle her being on it, too, because she helps me so much behind the scenes. She is actually the on-set tutor, so she takes care of the kids and makes sure they have their homework and get their schoolwork done on time whenever we have to miss for filming. But beyond that, everything I know I've learned from my mom, and I hope I turn out just like her and 20 years. She's only 20 years older than me. She's not that much older. But she's not the cook that Miss Kay is. I'll tell you that right off the bat. But she has other talents like writing and teaching children. And she's been involved with a camp that that Willie and I met at. And she and my dad met at for our whole lives. So there's a lot that people can learn from her. And I'm really proud to have been able to do this with her.
And I'm excited to have done this with Corey. Of course, we've done lots of things over the years together. She's been my best friend for many, many years. And I always tell moms when I work with them that if you do the right things when your children are little, then when they're grown, they will be your best friend. Don't be the best friend when they're little. Wait till they're grown for that. And so we've done a lot of things together. I mean, from weddings to vacation Bible schools to, oh my goodness, parties and so many things. So when we decided to approach this project, it was very natural for us to work together and have a lot of the same thoughts, of course, and the same background, and so it was great fun.
That's great. Well, and of course, you mentioned, Corey, you're on Duck Dynasty. If anyone that doesn't know, I don't know if anyone would not know that, but we want to make sure that everyone knows that you're a part of that, and that's where this came out of. The company is Duck Commander. The book is Faith Commander. I think the natural question is, and Corey, you can take this, how many overlaps are there? You know, how much of, you know, the Duck Dynasty show that people watch are they going to see in not only the book, but then the you know, the church curriculum that we're going to preview later?
Yeah, well, actually, it's a lot, I mean, because it's who we are. And, I mean, that's been really a neat thing because we were able to convey what the show, because the show is not, it's not preachy. It's not about... you know, about anything other than family and having a good time together and laughing at each other and at the end of the day sitting down and thanking God for what we have. But in this we're able to go deeper into our faith and what we believe. And I really believe there are a lot of lessons in the show that people can take from it. Like forgiveness whenever the guys, you know, get on each other's nerves and have to forgive each other or they forget an order. Or like, you know, the prayer at the end, like we talked about. And there's obedience where when our children, you know, are respectful of their papa Phil when he has them do things. So there's a lot in the show that can teach you, but it's not overt. It's just how we live our lives. Where this, we can be a little bit more, we can actually pull from the Bible and let people know why we live the way we do and why we make the choices that we make.
Yeah, and I think that's something that people love about the show and love about you is that they feel like they do know you so well. They feel like it really is a glimpse into your life. Chris, why this? Why now? You said you all have known, you know, the Robertsons far before, you know, even the marriage, before the joining of the families, 35 years. So tell us a little bit more about why this project now and why it just works so well for your families to work together on this.
Well, Corey mentioned about the Christian camp that we've worked with. We right. have worked with that now. My family, my husband's dad, started the camp 47 years ago.
Wow.
So it is a lifelong thing that our families are involved in, and the Robertsons as well. Missy helps out there every summer, too. And so our heart is with children and teaching children about God and about faith and about their family and how to live a better life. So, again, this was just kind of a natural progression for us. Our first thought was the Vacation Bible School, and we came up with the Willie's Redneck Rodeo because rodeos are big in the South and you know, kind of have that little rhymey thing, and we just thought that would be fun. And then it grew into this whole church experience through our work with Zondervan, and they have been just great partnering with us. And then we were able to bring the teenagers in, John Luke and Sadie and Reed and Cole and Will. And they have done videos for it and have spoken their heart to each of the topics as well. And the men came in and spoke their heart about each of the topics. So there's so much in this material. It's way more than a Vacation Bible School. And over the years when we've done our work with children and we've gone to the store and gotten what we needed for our VBS, sometimes it's not exactly perfect what we need. And this may not be exactly what your church will need, but it's so adaptable. There's so many things you can pull from. Mm-hmm. It was great. This was the time, we felt like it was the time for something like this to come out. Like Corey said, the show takes one level and this takes the next.
That's great. We're going to, again, unpack literally the box for you. I haven't gotten to look inside it yet, so we're going to do a big reveal in a little bit. But while people are still coming on, I want to remind everyone that you can tweet using the hashtag FaithCommander at FaithGateway as well. And before we answer some of those questions via Twitter, ladies, can you talk about, and Corey, you can start with this, how you have maintained this strong family bond when we hear, you know, we're living in an age of reality TV is the norm, really. This goes beyond reality TV. I mean, you really have, it seems, at least from our perspective, grown stronger and closer as a family, while so many other reality TV stars are pulling apart, there's divorce, there's just so much negative. How do you maintain that close family atmosphere and stay strong in your faith?
Well, you're right. It really has. It's brought us closer together. And, you know, we went into it with a lot of prayer, and we continue with it with a lot of prayer. So we look to God to work in our lives and to make sure we're giving him the glory in all of it. But our family motto is Faith, Family, Ducks, and in that order. And so that's how we live. You know, I think the ducks part, you can insert whatever is, you know, your thing. It doesn't have to be ducks, you know. For Phil, it was ducks, and so now it's ducks for all of us.
Right.
But faith is the number one thing. And then second is family. You know, it's just very important to us, and we really, we take our relationships with our family seriously. We don't take them for granted, and we make sure that we treat each other with the kind of love that the Bible talks about, kindness, patience, gentleness, self-control, and that's the way we try to live our lives. And the show has brought us together in that we're filming together all the time. You know,
right.
If you're filming a show, there's a lot of time we're just kind of sitting around waiting on lighting guys to set something up or whatever. So we are together all the time, and we love that. We enjoy that. But also we work on that. We make sure to keep our relationship strong. And the thing that I think that's kept us grounded is just we have stayed true to who we are and where we are. It's not like we changed our whole lives because we became these TV stars or whatever.
Right.
You know, we all live in the same neighborhood. We go to the same church. Our kids have the same friends they've had since preschool, and they don't even think anything about the fact that they're on TV. You know, this their friend, it's Sadie, it's John Luke, you know.
Yeah.
And so we really try to keep that stability for the family and for our children to make sure everybody doesn't forget where they came from.
And then they have Professor Art on the show to keep them humble.
That's right. And you mentioned you all live really close together. I mean, I know, Chris, I know your life is sunshine and rainbows. I know that you guys have that going on. But for those of us that have trouble with our extended families or, you know, that don't always get along, your mom had a great motto that she lived by and passed on. Tell us a little bit about literally where you all live, how you live, you know, so close together, and then what that sweet motto is that kind of you all stay focused on.
Absolutely. Well, we do all live on the same street, and people have teased us for years that we kind of have a little commune going over there. And really, here's the sad reality. We're all gone so much that we're so thankful we live on the same street. So
that's
that
interesting.
We have those opportunities to be together, see each other out in the yard, or you know, that kind of thing. And so my family, Corey is the common denominator on our street. She and Lily are in the middle, and then the other three brothers live on the same street. Jeff and Jessica just purchased the last house on the street, so they're moving in the next few weeks. And then my side of the family occupies the other houses on the street. So we have lived together as a family, and Corey grew up that way too. Other family members had lived there and moved in and out of the same street. And it really wasn't something my husband and I thought we were doing when we first bought this plot of land. It just worked out that way, and it's been such a blessing for us. But my mom is still living, and she lives across the street from all of us. So she's kind of she's like the gatekeeper of the key master.
Yeah, hers is the first house on the street.
Hers is the first house. So you got to go past mom to get down that street. You know?
I love it.
But Mama has such a great heart, and her spirit has always been for us as a family, from my mom and dad down to us six siblings and then on down to the grands and the great-grands, is that you just treat each other kindly. Mm. And that's the main thing, and I think I say that every day because I have the grandkids with me a lot, and I think one of the things I say the most is, oh, speak kindly. Think a kind response, you know. Think about what you're saying. So kindness goes a long way in getting along with family members. Everything isn't going to be sunshine and roses. Just isn't going to be, because that's life. But if we can learn to look at our family members in the same eyes that God looks at them, and speak kindly to them, and be patient, and wait something out, don't speak immediately, wait and see, then I don't say everybody can live on the same street with their family, but it worked for us.
Well, and you mentioned some of these characteristics. I mean, what do you feel that you have to combat now? Because these characteristics, you know, it's what God laid out, right? It's in Ephesians, it's in Corinthians, and the fruits of the Spirit. It's some basic tenets that we've seen to have pulled away from today in our society. What do you ladies, and you know, you can both touch on this, what do you feel like you're having to combat most now today as opposed to 15 years ago as a mom or as a grandma? What's that biggest challenge?
I think mostly as a society it's about maybe becoming more selfish. And it's the whole like maybe selfie generation or whatever, you know, and it's like that whole like self-esteem and all that, to where it's really all about you and making yourself happy and you getting number one and you deserve this and all that. And I think that that's been really detrimental to our society. And, you know, we really try to make sure, you know, our faith is first. The family as a whole is important. You're part of a family. It's a big family. It's not going to be all about you. You don't get everything that you want, you know. And the respect of the elders, and that's something that we are very strong about in our family. You know, the adults are the adults, and the kids are the kids.
I think fortunately we live in the South, and it's a common practice to be respectful of adults in the South, and we honor that, and we do value that. And one thing that I see in my ministry, I have a ministry called It's a Mom Thing, and one thing that I say is we've got to get away from the child-centered home and go back to the parent-centered home. And all of the Robertsons are great examples of that. They love their children. Their children they're at their children's events. They're with them. They do the things they need to do. But mom and dad are the king and queen of the castle. They don't let the children run the castle. They let mom and dad all the way down there. And that's something that we've done in our family, and that's what they do. And we just have this great sense of if our kids or her kids are over at Missy's or at Jessica's or they're at mine or at Alan and Lisa's or at my brother's, everybody's going to be treated the same way, and that's respecting the older people in the home and, you know, just being kind.
Is that what's in this box? Is there a king? Is there a crown or a scepter?
It might be a beard or something. I don't know. Yeah.
Well, we're going to get to this in just a second. I know we talked about the timing of why writing this right now, but by far the most popular question we've gotten on Twitter is, you know, what made you decide to write this small group Bible study? You know, you've taken Faith Commanders, a book, and taken it into this three-part Bible study. You know, Billy Eastman asked it. A lot of people are asking, why this study? Why is this your first?
Well, actually, all the brothers, I know this is going to be hard to believe, but all the brothers went to seminary, and they all worked in the church at some point. Whenever our children were little, we managed the camp, and I was the children's minister. Willie was the youth minister and the college minister at some point. Jace worked at the church. Al was a preacher for years and years. So we all worked in church ministry at some point in our adult life. And so I've been in those meetings where we're talking about, as a church, you know, okay, what are we going to do for the children, and how is that going to coincide with what the adults are doing and what the kids are, what the teens are doing? And I, you know, as a working in the church, we loved it when we could have a package that would hit everybody, because that's really hard to do. It's hard to find something that, like, everybody is going to benefit from, you know, right. They're too young, or it's too old, or the teens don't think it's cool, you know. And something about our show, something about Doug Dynasty, really all generations relate to. And I think it's because we have all generations on the show, from Jessica's little one, River, who's 5, to Bill, who's, I don't know how old Bill is,
67?
60 something, yeah. So Phil doesn't like to tell his age. He still thinks he's still young at heart. But so we have every generation represented on the show, and you know that I think that that's why we get it. We hear it all the time from people. Mm-hmm. It's really been amazing how people will say, "This is the only show we can sit down as an entire family and all agree on, from the 3-year-old to the grandpa. Like, we all watch it together," and that's been really a fun thing for us. We are so proud of that fact that we've been able to make a show that the family can watch together. And I think that we've translated that in this curriculum to where the entire church is going to really benefit from it.
Plus, we were starting to get lots of requests for it. I mean, people were saying, do you have anything that we can do for Vacation Bible School? Or, I have a small group. Have y'all put anything out? So we were already thinking about it, of course, and then we started hearing people requesting it. So we said, okay, let's do this. And a lot of people listening today don't know that my background is publishing. We owned Howard Publishing for 35 years, sold that to Simon & Schuster back in 2006. So our heart is with children and ministry and books and product, and that's what I did for many, many years. So again, another natural progression for us, where we started to see people really requesting this, and we said, we can do this. So we did.
I'm so glad you're shining a light on that, because you are so much more than what people see on just a TV show, both in your faith and your business background and your family. I think because of that, that's made this such an amazing product that people just don't realize that scope of the background that you have, whether it's the seminary or, like you said, even the publishing background, that really you know what people want because you are those families that are asking for that, but then you also have that to deliver the product well. Well, that's fantastic. We have another Twitter question from Beth Martin, and she says, how do you keep your kids on the straight and narrow, especially when they attend public school?
Okay. Well, all of our children attend the same Christian school, so it is a private Christian school. Mm-hmm. It's a large one, and I have always said, I taught at that school for 12 years, and I've always said that about Christian education, it's not to isolate kids from what's going on in the world. Our children are very exposed. All of our children go on mission trips with us in the summer. They're very exposed to kids through recreational ball games and all kinds of different things. It's really more to insulate them, so when the time comes, they're really prepared for what might come their way. So our kids are involved in a private school, but that doesn't stop them from being tempted and from there not being the right kind of examples around them. So again, that goes back to what they see in their family and us all staying on top of what each of the children are involved in. And they're going to make mistakes. The Robertsons are the first to say that, and they'll say that in this curriculum, that there have been mistakes made from the children. But it's not about mistakes. It's about recognizing that you've made a mistake, asking God to forgive you and moving forward, and the whole family moving forward with you. So that's, Corey, you can probably add to that.
Yeah, I was just thinking, while our children go to a Christian school now, Willie went to a public school, and he grew, and all the brothers went to the big public high school here in town, and you know, they really were made a difference in their school. Mm. They brought people to church. Our youth group grew when we were in youth group, and the Robertson boys came into our youth group. They actually went to a small little church growing up, and then whenever I was about 12 or 13, I remember when they started coming to Whitesbury Road, and oh my goodness, they were just the cutest boys you'd ever seen, and they were so funny, and they were, but they really were very spiritual even at that time, and our youth group grew partly because of the girls they were bringing. They were bringing in girls and converting. But
whatever it takes to bring them to Jesus, right?
It worked. That's right. They but our youth group grew substantially in the time that we were there because you know they were very proactive with sharing their faith even at that time, and in the school they were leaders, and you know I tell my kids all the time, you know, God didn't call you to just sit around and be timid. You know, He calls you to a spirit of courage, and He asks you to do hard things, and sometimes that means speaking up in the school that you're at or wherever you are, and you know, doing the right thing in spite of what else is happening around you.
I think the beauty of the show and the Robertsons and people out there getting to know them better through things like this and their books is none of them are doing anything differently than they were doing before. They were preaching, they were teaching, they were working, going on mission trips, all of that. Now they have a platform that's bigger, but they were already doing that anyway. Even John Luke and Sadie and Reed and Cole were already speaking at youth events and that kind of thing on a smaller scale. But now, you know, God's called them to a little bit bigger platform, and they're rising to the challenge.
And Cy was still Cy. You didn't ship him in just for the show?
Cy is Cy. Yes.
You can't make that stuff up, right? You
cannot make that up.
No.
Well, if anyone's just joining us, I want to reintroduce again Corey Robertson and Chris Howard, the co-authors of Faith Commander. If you want to join in, you can be a part of this chat. Just tweet us with the hashtag Faith Commander. Use at Faith Gateway to ask your questions. We've got some more Twitter questions, ladies, but this is killing me. I've got to open the box. I can't. Can we look at this now? I'm going to do my best Vanna White. I was voted most likely to be a game show hostess in high school. So I wish I was kidding. And so this is the 5-week churchwide curriculum. So this is the box that people can get. It's great packaging. I love this. Now I'm intrigued by this picture. Is this an actual picture of Willie there with the redneck rodeo? That's
that's an actual drawing of a picture of Willie.
That's great.
But it does look a lot like him. And
it does.
Yeah, we wanted that to be just fun for kids.
It's fantastic. Well, and we've alluded to this, that this is an adult study, a teen study, and a children's curriculum. So when you open this up, this is, again, living 5 values from the parables of Jesus. Wow. Okay. So we have the DVDs and the books in here. So let's look at first. We have the adult. I'm going to assume that this is the adult curriculum. Yes, Faith Commander. This is a book that I've read. So Faith Commander. And then you have the companion DVDs. Now there's 5 on here, and can I just say thank you? Thank you for not making the 16 things that we as moms and families have to try to live up to. Was that purposeful for those of us that are just trying to get by day, or was that just something that was laid on your heart?
I think that's a great idea for those who are just trying to get by day, but we really had the 1 week, you know, Monday through Friday thing in mind at first, but then it can be 5 weeks or whatever, however 5 you want to work them out, do it.
So we've got the 5 chapters are Redonkulous Faith, Radical Forgiveness, Ravenous Prayer, Real Obedience, and, of course, Rowdy Kindness, as we were talking about. And all the guys take part here. I'm looking at the DVD here, and you've got, I mean, Jace, Willie, Jeff, you've got Cy, Phil, everyone is on here. How did you tell the guys about this? How did you get them to be a part of it? But, I mean, like you said, you guys are all over the place, so how did you get them to really take an active part in this project?
Well, it's not really hard to get the guys to talk. They all talk. So
I preach.
Yeah, I preach. Talk about their faith for sure. That's not difficult at all. But our time is crazy right now. You know, our lives are really busy. So we just had to catch them and sit them down and say, talk about this, and then this did, you know. And like we said, it's kind of how we live our lives, and we are pretty much an open book. Everyone sees us on Duck Dynasty every week. They know our goods and our bads, and so we're very open with sharing that type of thing. And all the guys really shared stories from their lives of times when they were impacted by whatever, you know, the messes they were talking about. And I think you'll get to know them a little bit more, get to see some of the struggles and some of the good and some of the successes, and get to learn a little bit more about our family through this as well.
That's great. Well, as I continue to unpack this, I want to remind everyone there is a link below where you're watching this that you can click over to the store at faithgateway.com. And for 2 days only, we already had everything 20% off, ladies. You know I'm the savings expert, so I got to save people money if I'm going to talk about something, right? So 20% off, but now with the code COMMANDER, you can get an additional 25% off for 2 days only. So that's going to bring you to a total of 40% off retail any of the Faith Commander products over at our Faith Gateway store. So make sure you click over so you can look at this as I'm unpacking my box for the first time. Ladies, I think the teen edition here, I'm pulling this out, this is what intrigued me the most because, I mean, you alluded to this earlier, Corey, sometimes teens are just like, oh, this isn't cool. And, you know, you've really involved your kids, your teenagers especially, in this project. And like you said, they were speaking before. So the kids are represented on here. It's the same five principles. You know, those five values from the parables of Jesus, but what separates the teen edition from the adult version? What makes this so special?
Well, first of all, because the teens speak to the teens now, Jason, Phil, and all the guys can speak to the teens as well, and they've got such a great message to teenagers, but we really felt like it would be important for our teenagers to have their voice on there, and they have stories, and they can speak, and I was so proud of them when we, again, it's a scheduling thing. I mean, they're in school, they're in sports, they're speaking at appearances, you're filming, but once we got them nailed down to a time, and they showed up, and the camera got in front of them, I was incredibly proud of them, and what they offer is a teen look on these same topics, because it is going to look a little bit different when you're 40 or when you're 16, and so they're able to speak to where teenagers are today, and they do it in such a great way. Corey and I looked at the topics, and we tried to decide which teen should speak to which topic, and we looked at their lives, and even though they're short lives, they're not very old, they already could speak the topics we knew which one each one of them should have, and it just worked out great.
Yeah, and we've got John Luke, Sadie, Will, Reed, and Cole are all on here. I have to ask, and Corey, you can start out, what surprised you? Because even if you give a kid a script or tell them, they're going to surprise us, usually in beautiful ways. Was there anything that you two witnessed during the creation of this and then maybe the filming of the DVD that taught you a lesson that you didn't even realize your own kids knew?
Yeah, I mean, of course, as a mom, it's the most proud of that I ever am seeing them speak about their faith and sharing that. And I think that they do. They surprise me every time I hear them. But, yeah, I love seeing their hearts, you know, in this and seeing what has moved them and what has impacted them, you know, throughout this time, of even through Duck Dynasty. You know, John Luke talks about a little bit about how they're, you know, it rocked his world at first whenever it happened. You know, it was just like everything started going in super speed and we get busy and all that, and how he made it through that time and everything. So I think that it was neat for me to get to, you know, see them even sit there and share their heart, and I think people will really love that. And I think part of why it's important for the teens to be on there and speak rather than just having an adult tell you is whenever you can see other teens making right choices and doing the right things, I think it makes it easier for you to do that too, you know, to say, okay, it's kind of cool to follow God. You know, it's kind of, this actually is the way I need to be living, you know, and it's not, and just maybe help teens to get over that little bit of, like, embarrassment to speak up and say, hey, I'm a follower of God, I'm doing what's right no matter what the rest of you do, you know, and hopefully seeing our teens on this can kind of inspire our kids to do that as well.
Yeah, and surprised me was how honest they were and how real they were, because I had sat down with each of them and told them the direction that it needed to go, but I said, you guys have your own stories. And they did. They were just very honest, and even the guys who came down to film them were surprised at how honest and open they were and how professional they were for such a young age. They just did a really great job. We're really proud of them. It's not scripted. It's speaking from their heart, and that's the great thing.
I can't imagine you guys would have many dry eyes watching as a mom and grandma watching that.
I wasn't there when we filmed, but I was, and I was standing off to the side with a camera so I could get still shots. But it was like everything I could do to not just be boo-hooing.
I bet.
They did not need to see me do that. But it was really hard to listen to them, just share their hearts. And we filmed outside, and it was just a beautiful day. And so, yeah, it's great. I'm proud of them.
And I love, I mean, obviously we see them on TV, but the kids look like kids. I mean, they're still teenagers, like you said, that, you know, Corey, you said they're not really affected by the show. They still are who they are. I think for me as a mom with, you know, I have an 8 and 9 year old daughter and son, and we are, that's the one primetime show we let them watch that we can all sit together and watch as a family. You know, there aren't that many options. So I know for my kids, they would probably be more attracted to this, even though they're not teenagers. Before we move on to the VBS curriculum, can you give us a little more of an insight as to what, you know, parents can expect to see in this so they can make that decision of, well, is my in-between better off in the children's, you know, the redneck rodeo? Or are they, you know, is it okay to watch the, you know, the teen DVD? Or are they going to touch on some topics I don't want my kids to see yet?
Yeah. Well, Will's actually only 12, and, you know, we wanted him to do it as well because, you know, he and Bella's 11, 12, and they just now moved up to the middle school, which at our church is in the same, you know, facility as the teenagers are, and they're really using the older teens as mentors to the middle schoolers. And so I think it's great for middle school, preteen on up for sure. There's not going to be anything in there that you're going to think, oh, you know, this is too heavy for my child.
No, it won't be. As a matter of fact, the summer camp that we run, that age 11 and 12, they can go to the elementary session or they can go to the middle school session, and we let parents kind of decide that where they think they should be. But this curriculum, whichever the teen version, would be fine with an older elementary child. Absolutely has great things for it. And what's Willie always has a nickname for everybody, and right now he's calling Will Preen because he's a preteen. You
know. I love it.
He calls him a preen. And
that works.
That's just him. He's 12. When we filmed this, he was only 11. Mm-hmm. And so, but still, I mean, he's growing into his own person and had his own thoughts, and we wanted kids to see that.
Absolutely. Well, before we get to the much acclaimed VBS curriculum here, I want to tackle another question from Twitter. This one comes from Crystal Stein, and she's asking, has there been a Bible study that either of you have done that has really impacted your faith? And maybe, Chris, you can start out by thinking about that, especially, I think, faith, but I know I selfishly want to know, as a mom or as a wife, is there any study in particular that's really left an impact on you?
Oh, goodness, that is a tough question because I've seen so many Bible studies in my life, but one of the very first ones that came out was Experiencing God.
I
think that was kind of the kickoff for great personal Bible studies.
Right.
Of course, anything Beth Moore comes out with is great, but all the way back to the Experiencing God one was just so great and really taught me a lot about studying the Bible more in depth and getting deeper with your thoughts. And I have not done one personally in the last 2 years because I've been so busy writing different projects and different things like that. And in my writing, what's so great about writing is you have to study you know what you're writing about. And I love that too. So can you think of another one?
I was thinking that same one, and one of the lessons I remember learning from that I still really work on was learning about wisdom and how you can actually ask God for wisdom. The Bible says, "Ask for wisdom, and He will give it to you." You know, and I think before that I thought wisdom just happens when you get older, like you just, you know, gain it or whatever. But it talks about in the Bible actually asking for wisdom. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I do that a lot. I use that in my life. You know, when I'm going to go talk to somebody and I have a hard thing to say, I ask God to give me wisdom. And that's that I really learned from that Bible study. But I'm a reader. I love to read. I read books a lot, and I'm reading Killing Jesus right now about Bill O'Reilly, and it's really, really good and really powerful. But I have a hard time remembering what I read last because I'm kind of like a serial reader. I pick up the next book as soon as I put the last one down.
I'm one of those that has like three books on my nightstand at any given moment.
Me too.
However, I did read Killing Jesus already, so I can't believe.
You're ahead of me.
That's like never happened. Yeah.
You've got, and there's another question. I don't know. This was from before that I kind of skipped to because I wanted to open the box. But then let's kind of look forward and look at what do you hope that this Bible study will accomplish? What is your hope that people will get out of this study? We just asked about what's impacted you. What's the impact that you hope to have?
Well, one of the things that I really want, when Mom and I sat down first to just discuss what we were going to do, I really want it to be practical. Like, I wanted people to have just life lessons that they could take away and they could just actually make an impact on their life right now. You know, I didn't want it to be too, like, over their head that they had to think about for, you know, forever. Mm-hmm. And so that was one of the things we talked about. And Mom and actually came up with doing the parables because so much of the Bible studies, especially like VBS, are from the Old Testament, stories, and they're awesome and they're great. But you know, a lot of times we don't use the parables as much as you know can as give them their due, I guess. And so Mom came up with the idea of using the parables, and I loved it because you know, that's really what Jesus did. He used stories to teach us and to help us to learn really tough life lessons. And so that's what we did, and I'm just really proud of how it came out, and I think that people are gonna gain a lot from it that is practical and they can use in their everyday life.
Well, and for me, why I thought of stories is because there are no better storytellers than the Robertsons. Mm-hmm. I mean, those guys, by the time I always tell people, I was working with a youth group, and I still do, but really, really closely when these guys were teenagers. And when you were headed to Six Flags, you wanted Willie in your car. Because you're going to laugh for 6 hours. Because he just has a way, a gift with words and with stories. But all of them do. So telling, and when they speak with stories. And so this made sense to go back to the parables of Jesus, because he's just telling stories, everyday stories, that impact people's lives. And also that's why I wanted all the guys involved and all the teenagers, because they need to tell their story. Everybody has a story. And through their stories, other people will learn. And then we picked the silly, redonkulous, and radical, and ravenous, and real, and rowdy. Just with my publishing background, I like that all. With an R. I was like, okay, I'm going to make it all, you know, so it's easier to remember, and just some fun words. So you realize that we're not talking about faith. We're talking about redonkulous faith. I mean, a faith that is hard to even explain to other people. Mm-hmm. We're not just talking about forgiveness. We're talking about radically forgiving. Mm-hmm. When your brother and sister do something that just like knocks your socks off, and you think, how can I get up the next day? Mm-hmm. That forgiveness has to be radical. Mm. It's going to be over the top. So we picked just some fun words to go with it, and we hope that speaks to the kids and the silliness, and then also speaks to the adults, because, okay, maybe I need to use a word like redonkulous.
Yeah.
Just to describe my faith.
You know? Yeah, drive it across. Well, and I think Cy was the one that said in the videos, I mean, God has a sense of humor. Why do we think that God didn't have a sense of humor?
Absolutely.
And if you all haven't watched the preview of this, I mean, I think Jace starts off the preview that we have on faithgateway.com and just says, this is called Faith Commander? Wow, that was deep, huh? Deep. So it is that same humor that we get to see, but mixed in with that faith. What is there another story that you can share for people that haven't gotten to watch this yet that just really stood out that you're like, oh, that just cracked us up, but it's so true?
Some people have seen Reed and Jephthah's testimonies online, but both of them do such a fabulous job with being honest about what they've lived through, and their past, and how they've come out of that, and how their families forgave and loved them, and they've gotten a second chance. So that's great stories that I think everybody's going to, I would use the word enjoy, not enjoy, but everybody's going to be blessed to hear.
Yeah. Absolutely.
else, you know, those are powerful. And of course, Sai is just Sai. He's I gave Sai the topic of obedience because we thought about his so many years in the service.
Oh, true.
And that just made me think of my dad was a Marine, and when you're connected with anybody who's been Army, Navy, Marines, whatever, it's all about obedience. Mm-hmm. And so I just knew that Sai could speak to that in a great way, and he's great. Sai is so fun, and I think everybody will enjoy hearing him.
Yeah, people don't, you know, people know Sai from the show and see his hilarious, crazy side, and that is who he is, but they maybe don't see on the show that he is such a strong, godly man. He is at church every time the doors are open, singing at the top of his lungs. Mm-hmm. And it's pretty funny to sit in front of him because, I mean, he belts it out there. And, you know, and what's so funny, too, is he'll talk. Like, we have a big church. It's not like we're in this, like, little 30-people church. Yeah. We have 1,000 people there. And the preacher will ask a question, and he'll answer it, you know, yell it out. And or especially when Phil's preaching, you know how he kind of repeats everything.
Right, right.
Oh, he'll be back there repeating, because he and Phil will have talked about it the whole week.
Oh my gosh.
Prior to the lesson. And so Sai will start jumping in there, preaching from the back row as well. But he's a really great godly man and just a real sweetheart. And I think you see that a little bit more on that. In this, and you actually then comes across on the TV show.
That's great. The real question people want to know is, does he bring his iced tea cup into church with him?
Yes.
Oh, everywhere.
He does not leave home without it. Sure his jug and his cup.
Everywhere he goes. That's great. We've got another Twitter question. Remember that you can all tweet along with us and ask questions to Corey and Chris live. If you tweet with a hashtag of Faith Commander at Faith Gateway on Twitter, we've got one from Dead Bee here. And she says, this is to Corey. How do you handle negative stuff on the web? I dislike seeing it and try to ignore it. Love the Robertsons. So how much stock do you put in?
Yeah, you said it right there. Ignore it. That's pretty much how we do it. I tell the kids, you know, what – they don't know you. You know, what's really important is what God thinks about you and what your family thinks about the people who know and love you. And so, you know, we really just try to ignore it. You know, people, there is a lot of negativity out there. Mostly, though, you know, we get support. We have just incredible, incredible support from fans all over the country and world now. I mean, we get tweets from Scotland and Australia, from everywhere, you know. And we really get a lot of support and a lot of people telling us they're praying for us and a lot of people just telling us what the show means to them. And so that's the real blessing, and that overshadows the negativity. I mean, there are definitely some parts of social media that are just annoying, you know, and you just wish you could do away with them. But the good definitely outweighs the bad. We get a lot of real positivity and support, and that's been a blessing.
And you know, this is not something, this is what every person deals with. And because they're in the celebrity world and they get it on a bigger scale, everybody on whatever scale you live on, you deal with that. And so one thing that I've always told my children and Corey's told hers, don't believe the best you hear about yourself. Don't believe the worst. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a balance in there, and just keep your head where God wants your head to be and stay with your family, and you just ignore it and go on, because even whoever is tweeting about this, probably in whatever her world, her children deal with that too.
Yeah.
We've all dealt with that. So you just don't believe it. You know what God has for you, and you move on to that.
I love that, Chris. Don't listen to the best and don't listen to the worst. Just and stay close to the people that know you well, right? I've had to do that as a mom. I've had days where I just don't feel worthy, and I have to call my best friend and just say, just remind me. I've talked to Jesus, but I need to hear. remind me that I'm worthy, right? Sometimes we just need to remember that, and remembering who Christ made us to be. I love those words. Well, I want to keep digging into this box. Now, remember, everyone, just for the next 2 days with the code COMMANDER, you can save an additional 25% off any of the Faith Commander products. They're already on sale 20%, so for those of you math whizzes out there, that's a total of 40% off retail. Just go to store.faithgateway.com. Of course, I have to pull out of my box of fun here. You knew we were coming to it, right? We have got Willie's Redneck Rodeo VBS edition here. So what, I just can't even imagine, if this plastic wasn't on it, I'd be ripping it off right now. What exactly is in this DVD, ladies?
Okay, the DVD, this is really the new world we live in, where it's just not a whole bunch of paper, it's all in the DVD. Yeah. So when you put that in your computer, everything that you need to pull off a Vacation Bible School is on that DVD. So all the words they will say, a list of the songs they will sing, the script for the plays that they can put on, all of that's included on that DVD. So we're in the less paper world. This is less paper. I have stacks of Vacation Bible School material literally in my office from years of camp and mission trips and that sort of thing. So with this, you have a DVD, and you put it in your computer, then you print what you need.
That's fantastic. Well, and correct me if I'm wrong, though, but, I mean, wouldn't this be great just to do at home, whether it's just with your own family or just getting a small group? I mean, from everything that I can see on here, it's 5 lessons for preschool-age children, 5 lessons for children in kindergarten through 2nd grade. You've got a 3rd through 5th grade. You've got take-home discussion sheets. You've got, like you said, the worksheets, the coloring pages. I mean, I just want this for my family. I don't think you even, if you don't live where this is going to be a VBS, couldn't you do this at home?
Hey, absolutely, and it's on sale, you said, so you can you can actually get one right now.
It's a great deal.
Yeah, actually, it really is, we really did tailor to where, like you said, you print what you need. So, you know, you print off your worksheet for the day, and it's something you could do as a family, you know, take the summer and do once a week, or do it every night for 1 week and do it as a family as well. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, it's just fun stuff, like we have, like, different little skits that involve the family members that are just a lot of fun for the kids. They're gonna laugh and they're gonna learn, and you know, I think that's the best, when kids can enjoy learning about God. And our kids actually love church. You know, people have asked me, they're like, "How do you get your kids to go to church?" I'm like, they love it. Like, they don't want to miss. Like, if we, you know, are just exhausted at one night, you know, and I'm just like, maybe we'll just stay home. But no, Mom, no. Like, love it, you know. They, their friends are there, and it's fun, and they have good people that are speaking good things into their life. And so that's what we wanted, to make it fun. We want kids to fall in love with God and fall in love with His Word.
Well, I don't think it's going to be hard with this. And don't get me wrong, it's great at home, but you've got everything in here for a church to do this as VBS. You've got this church campaign starter guide, so how to launch the campaign, everything from the resource overview to the VBS, and then in here, this is like Mary Poppins' bag, you know, it just keeps going and going and going. We've got the leader guide here, so you really have thought of everything. I mean, it's a party in a box, really, right? We've got our own little party going on here. Everything that you could want is right here. So what would you suggest if someone seeing this is like, I want to do this at my church, maybe their church has never done VBS, what encouraging words would you give them to actually bring this to their church?
Oh, I think that whoever wants to do this, you just go to whoever the leadership in your church is and show them all the possibilities for your church. And I think they're even online, there are in some of this, I believe, is words to say to your church leaders or your small group leadership or whoever you need to go to.
Oh, you do. You're right. You've got how to establish, how to promote, how to fine tune.
But try to think about everything, because we've been on the other end of it. So to think it through, and this company, this is what they do. They're just so great at this, and they helped us think through things. We helped them see things that we did as consumers, what we always were missing, what we wanted. And, of course, the director's guide, I've got mine holding it up here too, and it is a hard copy because us director people, we want to have that in our hands.
Absolutely.
You know? We want to be able to write on it and scratch out and say, okay, now I need this, and keep our checklist together. Mm-hmm. So this is your hard copy. And then you have your DVD with all your other things that you need on there.
Well, and there's even, you know, this, you've got door signs, you've got door hangers, there's postcards to mail out, there's, you know, you've got literally, you've thought of everything. Now, the big question that we're getting on Twitter now, this one is asking, you know, 5 weeks is a perfect study. I think they're right there with us on that. But we're already getting questions about the next one. Is there any plans in the works for a second study? Where do we go after these 5 weeks?
Okay, that's a good thought.
we'll get right on that.
Yeah, we're going to get on that. Thinking that through, we really are thinking that through because we do, I mean, we do want this to be successful. As Corey said, we took things that we think the Robertson family show each week, like the prayer and obedience and kindness. We think that's shown on the show, and that's what we wanted to bring in this curriculum. But we know that there's even more, and so we are working on that and thinking about that, and not sure yet what the next one will be, but I'm sure Willie's going to have something coming up.
I think we'll have to announce it on another chat. We'll have to, you'll hear it here first.
There you go.
What's coming up? Well, ladies, believe it or not, we only have about 10 minutes left. So again, tweet your questions to hashtag Faith Commander. Make sure you use the coupon code Commander to save a total of 40% off retail of any of the Faith Commander products through our Faith Gateway store. That is only for 48 hours, just 2 days to save. You're going to see that link underneath of where you're watching the video here, or you can go to store.faithgateway.com if you're watching this later. Hopefully not too much later, because you just have a couple days. Ladies, this is, I have to ask, it's almost, I'm sure, like picking a favorite child, but do you have a favorite chapter? Do you have a favorite, you know, book is one you're like, oh, well, I just love the teen, or the adult was the first, so that's what I love more. Is there something that you personally like better?
I'm terrible with favorites. I can pick a favorite song. My kids try to get me to do it. I'm terrible.
Our kids are terrible with that. They get on the diving board and want us to choose. No, we're not. You know, y'all job, go. No, I don't think there is one, but you know, the different in the Vacation Bible School, I think what's the fun thing is we've also picked people's skills, like Miss Kay is the cook. So of course that's the station they go to for food.
Gotcha.
And so they'll go to Miss Kay for food, and then what goes on at the warehouse? Everybody knows what goes on at the warehouse. Yep. Nothing really. But a lot of fun and getting to know each other better. So in when they get to the warehouse station, that's where they play their games and get to know each other better and get to go deeper into what the lesson was for that day. Mm-hmm. And now Corey, a lot of people don't know this, Corey's an art education major. So Corey was in charge of our craft shed at camp for like 19 summers for a long time. So when you go to Corey's little rotation station, you're going to do a craft. So it's just a lot of fun stuff in here, a lot of fun. And whether you do it at home with your two kids or your entire church of 200,000 do it, it's great.
Yeah.
Great fun.
I will choose a favorite.
Here we go.
Radical forgiveness, I think, is something that is so important, and in our family's life, particularly the Robertson family, that point when Phil turned his life around and Kay forgave him was, we would not be here, we would not be sitting here talking to you today if that point had not happened. And you know, it took both. It took Phil changing, and it took Kay forgiving.
Yeah.
And it was a radical forgiveness. It was one that most people would have said, you know, I can't trust you. There's too much bad that's happened, and you put us through 10 years of hard times. And, you know, most people wouldn't have done it. But Kay really chose that radical forgiveness. And that was, you know, that's what brought us here today. You know, we would not be here. We would not have the dynasty as a family, being able to speak to you and making the impact for God that we hope that we're having without that radical forgiveness in our family.
Corey, speak a little more to that. I mean, I know we've joked and we've had fun, and you know, as we come to a close here, I kind of feel impressed that there are some women out there that may be in those shoes that Kay was in right now. I mean, this isn't just happy, fluffy. This isn't just a word that we're throwing around. I mean, when you talk about that radical forgiveness, there's women that have been, I mean, men too, but I know there's wives out there, moms that have been hurt, and they're hurt by their husband's choices or by their children's choices, and some of them are just saying, I just don't know how, I want to, but I don't know how. Is there some encouragement that you can give after, you know, watching, you know, this a little bit, and I'm sure experiencing it in your own life, for that woman out there that's just saying, I so desperately want to, I just don't know if I have it in me. What would you say to her right now?
I think that you cannot really stay married without having that radical forgiveness, offering that to the other person, and at some point they're going to have to offer that to you, because we are not perfect.
Yeah.
But you know, all of our struggles are different, and you know, for those that go through just really, really hard stuff and really hard times, you know, I know that it's not easy. And I think that's when you look to God and his example of sending Jesus to the cross and his forgiveness of us when we're not perfect. We make mistakes. We let him down all the time. And you look to that. And then on a practical level of how to live it, it's just day by day, it's choosing it. It's choosing forgiveness every day, you know. And then in my experience, when I've had to do that for someone and someone has it for me, it's about choosing it and then choosing it the next day and choosing forgiveness the next day. And then all of a sudden, you don't have to choose it anymore. It happened. It's part of how you are and who you live and how you live. But it's not easy, you know, but it's what God calls us to do. He calls us to forgive. I mean, he actually tells us, forgive so that the Heavenly Father can forgive you. Mm-hmm. And it's not an easy thing, but it is. It reaps tremendous rewards in your life. And you're really the one who wins in the end. You know, if you hold that in, hold that grudge, and hold that bitterness, it's going to affect you in ways. And that's really why God tells us to do it. He's looking out for us. Like, his commands and his word is to help us live a better life. He knows that if we live with bitterness and hold things in, that we won't live a happy life. We won't live the kind of life he calls us to do. But if we can forgive and let it go and choose love, then our lives will be better. And he promises that. And I've seen it in my own life and in the lives of our family.
And I think hearing stories of people who have done it do give you great strength. You know, when people say, how do you do it? I can't do it. Mm-hmm. I always say, no, you can't, but God can.
Right.
You're right. You can't. But with God in your life, you can do it. And when you see, you hear stories like Phil and Kay and other people who've done it, you can tell yourself, if they can do it, I can do it with God's help. And it's a lot of prayer, and sometimes it's 24/7 listening to Christian music so that everything that goes in your heart and your head is the right thing.
Absolutely. We have one last Twitter question I want to sneak in so we can get Lori's question in here. She said, how have you handled the challenges of fame and wealth, particularly with your kids? Do you have a two-minute kind of synopsis as we wrap up?
You know, part of what I tell people is, you know, it's not any different than the way, than your life. You know, we all have challenges. We all, like we talked about, everyone has probably experienced some hate on social media or somebody who, you know, I talked about to Sadie, you know, girls are girls in high school. Everyone experiences mean girls in high school, whether you're famous or whether you're not, you know. And there's always challenges of being, everyone's too busy, and like our lives are all too full. There's all these choices that you have to make to keep balance in your life. So I really don't think that our struggle's any different than you know, everyone else out there. I think it's you know, it's in the spotlight and other people see it. And when we fail, everyone knows about it. but I don't think our struggle is really any different. I think it's just a matter of putting one step in front of the other and
keeping the first things first.
Yeah, trying to live for God wherever you are. And you know, it's not about waiting for God to put you in this place to live for God. It's wherever you are, living for God and using whatever gifts he gave you and whatever talents that you have and the platform that you have to be salt and light for him on this earth.
So true. It's not about waiting for that opportunity to hit you and then getting prepared. It's about being prepared so that when the opportunity comes, you have a reason to share that faith that we have, right? Ladies, this has been a joy. I could keep talking to you forever. I know our audience could keep listening, but for now, you'll have to take them home in a box, right? You can get the Faith Commander, the book, or the 5-week curriculum. Remember, you can get that at store.faithgateway.com right now. Use the coupon code COMMANDER to save 40% off retail only for the next 2 days. You can get that. Make sure you check out, of course, Duck Dynasty, Corey Robertson, Chris Howard, thank you so much, ladies, for not just being here today, but for caring enough about your family and passing on what God has given you to bless the rest of us. I can't thank you enough for being here today.
Thanks for having us. We enjoyed it.
Make sure you check out all of the great Faith Gateway products on faithgateway.com. Again, we'll have more from Corey and Chris on there. And it's been a joy to have you. I'm Sammy Cohn. I'm your family section curator. Thank you so much. And continue the conversation with hashtag FaithCommander at Faith Gateway. Until our next author chat, we'll see you. Bye.